Welcome to Nasdaq Trade Talks. I'm Jill Malandrino, Global Markets Reporter at Nasdaq. Joining us remotely, we have Frank Poor. He's the CEO of Commerce Hub. We're going to learn about the future of the digital supply chain. Frank, it's great to have you with us. Certainly surreal times in how we are practicing e-commerce and what's happening with our global economy. Tell us about Commerce Hub and what are you seeing in terms of e-commerce activity?
So Commerce Hub is in the business of connecting retailers and suppliers for the purpose of setting up a digital supply chain, as you referred to. These suppliers are drop shipping products directly to customer. So we work with the largest retailers and marketplaces in North America, and we connect to more than 12,000 suppliers who are actually receiving orders from these retailers and then in turn shipping those products directly to consumer. So the retailer doesn't actually have to buy them, doesn't have to bring them into their warehouse, and doesn't have to distribute them themselves. They're taking the orders and relying on a distributed network of suppliers to get the goods to the consumer. Just in terms of scale, we did about $20 billion in gross merchandise value sales last year through the platform on behalf of those, you know, 40 or 50 large retailers and marketplaces, and like I said, 12,000 or so suppliers, brands and distributors.
Is your data showing any significant change to being fulfilled and shipping on time? Most of my shipping has been pushed back about 4 to 5 days, although I did get a new headset for remote content that got delivered in less than 24 hours. So I'm definitely seeing a disparity in terms of shipping times. Is your data showing any of that?
So what's happening is obviously certain retailers are, have a couple of warehouses. And if a warehouse goes down for some reason, they've got a someone who's been identified as positive and they shut down the warehouse, it creates a big disruption for them. What we're seeing is, obviously a significant uptick as stores are closing and more businesses going online. We're seeing people buying from, you know, other retailers other than just Amazon, right? Amazon had Prime and now, you know, if you're talking Prime, you know, it could be 3 weeks for your goods, right? Other retailers are stepping in to pick up. There's a lot of pickup in store, buy online, pick up on store, and a lot of stores are setting up pickup points outside. What we're seeing so far is mostly an increase in terms of, the number of orders that are being placed. And, you know, we're certainly seeing a shift in the type of product mix that's being sold. It's moving obviously away from things like apparel and into, you know, household products and arts and crafts and toys and the other kinds of things that people are going to be buying in this kind of environment. But we're not seeing at this point from a data perspective, significant adjustments in fill rates. Most of the suppliers that are on our network are used to volume and can single pick, pack and ship single items. As retailers take in orders, they're, you know, distributing that order load, if you will, across a number of different suppliers around the country. And so it's probably putting less strain. You know, I think out of the 12,000 suppliers so far, we're aware of about 41 that have shut down their warehouses. But there's significant diversification if you can leverage a network of dropship suppliers and 3PLs with core items and, you know, items that you may want to bring on in a situation like this.
Let's talk about the future of the supply chain. Do you see it becoming even more digitized as we adopt e-commerce as the norm? Because I would imagine, and this also applies to global markets, that if this were to happen, let's even say 15, 20 years ago, we weren't as digitized and able to work from home and able to have this massive distribution network, it wouldn't happen unless we were digital. Do you think that is going to continue to evolve and we'll see more and more digitized supply chains and logistics?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we were publicly traded at one point. Early on, we didn't have cybersecurity attacks. You didn't need to be audited for that kind of thing with SOC compliance and that sort of thing. People are going to have to be SOC compliant now to withstand these kinds of distributed environments. And the companies that have, set themselves up to be digital, companies, whether it be retailers that have created, the online versions or direct to consumer brands, or brands that have adopted a direct to consumer model, or companies like Netflix and Peloton and others that are very digital first, they're really the ones that are going to thrive in this environment, right? So I think that those companies are going to be the ones that survive, and they're going to have done it because they built this kind of infrastructure. Amazon has hundreds of warehouses. They own thousands of trucks and planes. So if UPS shuts down or someone else were to shut down, they've got the ability to maintain a continuous flow. And so the companies that have set up these infrastructures do really well. The restaurants that set up to distribute through Uber Eats and Grubhub and all these others, are in a lot better shape than the ones who never adopted those kinds of things and just had in restaurant kind of scenarios. Now they're closed. Darwin said it's not the strong that survive, it's the most adaptable. And so businesses that haven't adapted either need to adapt or they're going to get left behind.
Yeah, that's great insight. I'm sure we're going to see more Darwinism play out as we get through the next few weeks and months. Frank Poore, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. I appreciate the time.
All right. And thanks for joining us on Trade Talks. I'm Jill Melandrino, Global Markets Reporter at NASDAQ.